How's it going? This is episode 33 of My Life as a Psychiatry Resident. Today is Friday. It is the Friday after Thanksgiving. So I figured I'd give you a heads up, a little bit of insight into what's been going on. Because I'm on inpatient psychiatry, I'm not in a clinic, so the hospital stays open, obviously. So I had to work on Thanksgiving. It wasn't terrible. I was able to go to a turkey trot in the morning, missed kind of the late morning, early afternoon stuff, and was home by late afternoon to be with the family. But it's almost like a rite of passage, I guess you could say. It's not ideal, and no one wants to do that. It's not like they get paid time and a half to come in or anything like that. But that's just part of being a resident, and specifically being on an inpatient service. So I figured I'd talk about a couple of cases that occurred this week. Obviously, these cases are real patients that I've had. They're real people. They're not meant to provide medical diagnosis or treatment ideas for those who may watch this. It's basically just to give an insight into what's going on, kind of my train of thought and my training as a psychiatry resident. So first patient I'll talk about, he's a 21-year-old black male who I inherited earlier this week. And he had been on the unit for a couple of days before being transferred to me. I had seen during treatment team, I had kind of heard his story. I'd seen him on the unit. And from what's very, very interesting is that while on the unit and my observation, he seemed, for lack of, layman's terms, he seemed out of it and out there. Definitely responding to internal stimuli. He had this tactile stuff going on where he was always pretending to be smoking marijuana. He'd do this a lot. He'd feel his face and touch his face a lot. He'd walk around with like a bag of chips or like crackers and holding it up to his nose and just sniffing it like all day long. And so then he gets transferred to me. And he had been like that for like a week, right? And no improvement. So he comes to me, so I see him the first day, and you can't have an examination with him. The stuff he's saying is incoherent, it's delusional, it's disorganized. You really don't know what's going on. He doesn't answer questions appropriately, and the whole time he's, smoking pretend marijuana joints. And so talking to his mother said that he was a fine and normal kid, graduated high school until about 6 months ago when she says he started to smoke cannabis. And she says he must have gotten some bad weed from some friends and it made him like this, okay? There is a history of bipolar disorder on the mother's side, no other psychiatric history in the family. And so what's interesting is that first day, he's out there. So I bumped up, I put him on, he was on an antipsychotic, and I switched him to Risperdal, 2 milligrams twice daily, just to see what's going on. And after that, I was, went to the treatment team and I said, look, if this is how he's been for a week, I don't know how he's going to be able to function. We might be looking at a state hospital, transition where he's in, care of the state and we send him to long-term state hospital because you guys have been treating him for a week and nothing has changed. I'm going to try this new medication, but if he's like this, there's nothing we can do. He's just going to be long-term care. And so the next day I came in and performed an exam and he was a little more clear. He was able to fill out his check-in sheet with the therapist. He was able to answer questions mostly appropriately. He was able to provide a little bit of more history of what was going on, what had happened in the past, how we got to the hospital. And so clearing up a little bit. So I'm like, okay, maybe we're making some progress. And then the next day he was even clearer and I was able to have a full examination on him. He answered every single question. Every question and answer was coherent. He responded appropriately. And I was like, okay. So I canceled the referral to the state hospital. And I said, no, I'm not going to have to proceed with the 1021. I think we can cancel this. If he's like this, he can go home. And so, yesterday on Thanksgiving, I was able to have another exam with him and he was still continue to improve. He was much more clear. Everything he answered appropriately and the examination went really, really well. was able to talk to him about his drug use, and he said he had started to use marijuana during the 11th grade, actually, not what his mom had said 6 months ago. He generally just smokes it with his friends, probably every other day. He really doesn't have a job, so he can't afford it. He just gets it from his friends. And besides this acute psychosis that occurred, I couldn't find really a pattern for schizoaffective disorder, much less schizophrenia. I couldn't really find a bipolar diagnosis that would fit him. And so it was kind of a psychosis, unspecified diagnosis, and then he has another diagnosis of cannabis abuse. So I was able to have a conversation with him and say, look, buddy, when we take drugs or alcohol or anything that changes the chemical balance in our mind, you're just messing yourself up. You're playing Russian roulette. And especially if I'm trying to help and give some medication to you, but you're high, it's not going to work. And the old saying that I use, it's like teaching someone to swim who's actually drowning. You can't do it. You got to save them from drowning first, and then you can teach them the backstroke. So that's what it was like with him. I can't help you if you're high. You got to have a clear head. You got to be not on any substances in order for us to help you with what's going on mentally. He was kind of, I think he was surprised. I called him out and said, you got to quit smoking dope. I don't think he was too happy about that. And quite frankly, I don't feel that he'll abstain from smoking. But anyway, yesterday I increased his risperdal to 3 milligrams twice daily. He was wanting to go yesterday. I said, no, I'm changing your medication. I want to see you at least 24 hours and see if there's any side effects, especially because we've increased the risperdal quite a bit. So today when I saw him, he was doing great. Answered questions appropriately, no issues, no EPS symptoms. So we were able to discharge him home today, back to his mom's house. So that's an interesting case of what I believe was a psychosis, probably due to something he smoked, could have been laced with something. Marijuana today is much stronger and much more concentrated than it was back in the summer of 69. So anyway, he's only 21, his brain's still developing. Hopefully he's able to stay away from that stuff and lead a productive life. I have another patient. He came to me, today is day 3 on the unit. He was on the mental health unit and was discharged last week. He was home for about 5 days and then came back. What's been going on is he's been endorsing to me auditory hallucinations. He's been endorsing also persecutory delusions, where he feels that his cousin, who lives in the house with him, and his cousin's friends and some extended family members are trying to kill him. And so since being discharged about 10 days ago, he went home, was extremely paranoid, extremely delusional that these people are trying to kill him. They would invite him, according to him, they'd have, you know, parties out in the front yard or whatever, and they'd invite him out to join, and they'd give him marijuana, they'd give him drugs, they'd give him alcohol or whatever, and then they'd sit around, you know, flashing their guns, and he saw that as a sign that they were trying to kill him. No one's ever harmed him. No one has ever made an attempt at him. I've asked him all these things, you know, but he just knows it. He says that he can hear just indiscriminate voices all around talking about him. He says that at night he hears, you know, voices telling him to be calm or to stay safe, and he thinks he hears their voices just right outside their window trying to kill him. And so he came back to us. He recognizes that our facility is a safe place. And so it's been interesting to kind of talk to him and figure out what's going. So I started him on risperdal as well. After talking to him, he hadn't been taking his medication since being discharged 10 days ago and had also come back positive for marijuana, alcohol, cocaine, and meth in that week's time. His UDS was positive for all those things. So not a good combination if you have a mental health disorder, or actually not a good combination for anybody. And so started him back on his risperdal, and each day it's been clearing up. And so today I said, all right, talk to me about these voices. Are people putting thoughts in your head that aren't yours? You're hearing things that other people can't hear. You know, what are they saying? When is this occurring? When is it not occurring? What's going on? And basically what I found out, he's still being told to be careful, is what the voices are telling him. But they're only occurring at night, and they're only occurring when he first lays down to go to bed before he goes to sleep. nothing during the day, nothing waking him up or anything like that. And it's the same thing, be careful. And so today that gave me some more insight into what's going on with him. So I have to say, okay, are these voices you're hearing, are you really hearing them? Or is that just you playing that on the mind, out in your mind? Maybe, you know, the delusion is real. I believe he's experiencing that. But these auditory hallucinations, maybe they're not. Maybe that's just him saying, these people are out to get me, be careful, be careful. And anytime he lays down, it's at night, maybe he's nervous to fall asleep. Maybe, you know, he's got some time to think because he's just laying there. That starts to replay in his mind. So it could just be him. It's also before he's fallen asleep, so hypnagogic hallucinations as well. So that's kind of what I'm playing with. So is it really him hearing voices? I'm not convinced that it is. I think it's more of himself playing in his mind. It's not happening all the time. So the plan for him is to increase the Risperdal. Hopefully that helps throughout the weekend. And then hopefully when I see him again on Monday, he'll be doing a lot better and will report to me that he's not having these issues. Every day has gotten better. He specifically said today that his mind feels clearer, that he's able to think a lot better. He's an interesting person in that he really enjoys group therapy. Says he likes to be able to express himself. He's not able to do that at home. He likes to be able to have kind of the positive reinforcement and understand that those that are in the group with him are going through the same thing he is. And so that's nice for him. I do think he's using our facility kind of as a crutch. He does feel safe. He's not paranoid when he's here. But, you know, he's got to develop those coping skills and stay on his medication and away from drugs when he leaves in order to stay stable. Pleasant guy, but that's what I'm working with through with him. Final patient I'll talk about is kind of interesting. A 28-year-old black female who was brought in a couple of days ago. And what's interesting is she was brought in with severe depression. She was put in on 1013 because she was heard to be saying she wants to just disappear from here. Now, everybody's going to be very, very safe with people in mental health and suicide claims or ideation. And so when someone hears that, they're going to say, oh my gosh, that means she wishes she was dead. So she's suicidal. So we have to put her on what's called a 1013, meaning the police have to grab her and keep her involuntarily in the hospital. Okay. So when I get her, I'm like, all right, what's going on? You know, what's this? And she's like, no, she's like, I am depressed. I have a really, really, really low mood. But I don't, but when I say I want to disappear forever, that's, I want to leave. I want to go to my house, get my birth certificate, get my social security, get my stuff, and leave my family. And I want to go to a different state. She gave me the state she wants to go to. With some more exploring, you know, she's had a lot of issues with her family. She uses a wide variety of drugs. And because of that, I think she's burned a lot of bridges with her family. And so it's just a really, really difficult relationship. She apparently had, she told me that she was concerned there might be a warrant out for her arrest because she was leaving her house to go live in an abandoned car that she knew about. And apparently her mother called the police and said that she was naked walking around the street. She said, I was naked, but I have a blanket wrapped around me, so I wasn't really naked. But then that leads to some of the judgment and insight of why were you naked? You know, what kind of psychosis is going on that you would leave the house naked and your plan was to go live in an abandoned car, right? So she does have quite significant mental health issues as well as substance abuse issues. So started her 3 days ago on Zyprexa at night. She's reporting poor sleep, so okay, we'll give you 20 milligrams at night. That went on for 2 days. She was still endorsing, she was saying she was thinking clear, but she's still endorsing a really depressed mood. So I started Wellbutrin just to kind of give her a mood boost. And then she reports that her mood is improving. You know, her anxiety and depression scores are dipping a little bit, but she's still reporting poor sleep. She's on Zyprexa at night. That should knock you out pretty consistently, but this is not. And as she has a lot of drug abuse, I'm not going to use a benzodiazepine. I'm not going to use a sleep aid or anything like that. And so what we're deciding to do is use Thorazine 100 milligrams at night. What's great is that I am at a program where a lot of my attendings allow me the freedom to open up the textbook of pharmacology and say, use it and get your own experience from it, which is awesome. There are standard medications that I see more often, that I use more often, but I'm grateful to have attendings that say, you have free game. I'm gonna watch what you do and make sure you don't do anything crazy that'll really, really hurt somebody, but I want you to have the experience with all of these medications, and I want you to be able to leave here and have that experience and be confident that you can use all these medications. So Thorazine it was the original antipsychotic invented back in the 50s. They used it for sedation and as an anxiolytic during surgery back in the 50s. It worked, but not really, really well. And since then, all the other antipsychotics have kind of been developed from that as a base. It doesn't get used a whole lot. It has a high risk of side effects. And so a lot of providers are scared to use it, or a lot of new psychiatrists are scared to use it just because there's a lot better and clearer medications out there. However, it works really well. If you have a patient who you've been using, antipsychotic medication on, and they're still continuing to be aggressive or agitated, you could use Thorazine as an intramuscular injection to sedate them. It won't necessarily clear them up in their mind as much, but it will cause some sedation. And so that's what I'm trying with her, is she's already on a good dose of an antipsychotic for her mood, but we do need sleep. I don't want to give her anything that could be addictive, so I'm going to give her this old first generation antipsychotic for sedation. So we'll see how it goes. Kind of excited about that. I've never given this to anybody. When I presented my plan to my attending, he smirked and he said, absolutely, do it. He's going to watch it. And so we'll see what happens. Anyway, just kind of an interesting case and being able to use an interesting medication combination. But anyway, that's my week. It's been pretty good. Worked Thanksgiving, which was a bummer. I was done with my patients, presenting my attending, doing my medication orders and notes by about 12:30 today on a Friday. I can't complain. That gives me the afternoon to make videos like this and study and kind of be on call for the nurses if they need anything. But yeah, that is Thanksgiving week as a PGY1 psychiatry resident.